Hello there! So today I am here with special guest Rick Riordan, author of basically my childhood, Percy Jackson and the Olympian series, Heroes of Olympus, also wrote the Kane Chronicles, somewhere in there, in your spare time, right?
Absolutely, my spare time.
Yes. The final book in the Heroes of Olympus series just came out last week, The Blood of Olympus. So tell me, what's been the biggest difference as far as the writing experience and the new characters between writing Percy Jackson and the Olympians and the Heroes of Olympus series?
Yeah, great question. Oh man, I mean, everything was different in a way, even though it's the same world, but I think the big thing was having so many protagonists, this big cast, seven heroes that are on this quest, and each one has their own voice and their own personality. So it was really trying to do justice to all seven of them. And have them all have a different sounding perspective. So that was a challenge, but of course, you know, now that I have all seven of them, I can't imagine life without them.
Yeah, did you have a favorite perspective to write from all the seven?
You know, I like them all for different reasons. I think probably Leo Valdez, just because I'm always drawn to the jokers.
You know, the sense of humor can come out through him.
Exactly, yeah. So he's my favorite, I think. Yeah.
So would he be the character that you're most proud of all the seven, how far they've come throughout the five books?
I don't know. I mean, I'm proud of all of them for different reasons. They've all really, I think, come into their own by the end of Blood of Olympus. At least I hope the readers feel that they have. So I'm proud of them all for different reasons.
Do you think there are any characters that are sort of neglected when it comes to fan attention? Because, you know, Percy and Annabeth are always the ones that people focus on a lot. But
sure.
Do you have a favorite one where you're like, guys, this is the best one. Why are you focusing on this, you know?
Yeah, I mean, at different times I feel that way about different characters. I think that Piper and Jason are the characters that tend to get some hate because people see them as sort of the anti-Percy and Annabeth, substitutes for them, and so they get very protective about Percy and Annabeth. But I don't think that's not really the way to look at it. I mean, they're just different characters in the story. And I think that in the last book, that's why I tried to focus again on Jason and Piper, because they really did need some love. And I think by the end of that book, they both have proven that they're very important on this quest too.
Right. So it's been about 10 years of Percy Jackson books. So now the fans of Percy Jackson sort of range from like the 10, 11, 12 year olds who just discovered it in the past few years to like teenagers like me who have been following it every year since it started. And then you also have like the 20 year olds and the parents who read it just because it's awesome. So what's most interesting to you about the difference in the fan mail and the comments that you get from different readers of all different ages?
Yeah, you're right. It's a huge spectrum, and I never really anticipated that. I was a middle school teacher, and I kind of saw this as just something I might write for my middle school kids, like 6th, 7th, 8th grade. But even from the very beginning, I mean, older readers were getting into them, and now those kids are in their 20s. So it's been a big change. You know, everybody comes at it from a different perspective. I think that the teen readers are more interested in sort of the relationship angle, and the younger kids are more interested in kind of the personal development of each character and sort of the heroic aspect, like what cool powers can they have. But it's fun. It's a great thing to have something that can appeal to kids of whatever age.
In your writing, you're pretty well known for your life ruiners, I mean cliffhangers.
Okay.
So what I'm curious about is how do you know when your work is done? Do you plan from the beginning how the ending is going to be, or do you just sort of get to a place where something really big happens and then laugh evilly at your computer?
So sometimes I'll laugh evilly, that's true. But no, usually I do know where the story's going to end, and absolutely, I love cliffhangers. Now, my definition of a cliffhanger is a little different from the fans. You know, mine is like, the guy's literally hanging off a cliff and you don't know if he's going to die in the next like 30 seconds. I mean, that's my idea of a cliffhanger. I think the fans have more of a, but I don't know the whole story, you know, and that's a cliffhanger. I get that, but yeah, I was famous for that in my classroom. I would always end the class period on a cliffhanger and say, and then suddenly, oh, look at that, it's time for math. And the kids would get mad, but they were also really anxious to come into class the next day.
It makes them excited to come back.
Yeah. So that's why I do that.
Yeah. So while you're writing, what other sort of art inspires you? Do you listen to music, or how do you like get into the zone of this world?
I I do listen to a lot of music. I go to a lot of concerts, and I like all kinds of music, from blues to jazz to modern alternative to, you know, classical. I pretty much everything. While I'm actually writing, I can't really listen to anything that has lyrics, because it kind of messes with the writing stream. But I will sometimes listen to jazz or something like that. I love visual art. We take a lot of trips to the museums, and that is always inspiring because you get to see sort of how characters are portrayed through art, and that can be really, really informative when you're trying to describe characters in writing.
Yeah. So how long every day do you write?
It really varies a lot. It kind of depends on where I am in the process and what else is going on. I mean, like Percy, I'm kind of ADHD, so, you know, if I set a schedule for myself, I would break it immediately. I can't do schedules. Mm-hmm. But I at least write 2 or 3 hours a day, unless there's like an on tour or something like that. But sometimes I just really get in the zone and I'm revising and something's due in a week, for instance, and then, you know. Then it might be 12 hours a day.
Yeah, wow. So you have a new series coming out next year, Magnus Chase.
Yeah.
Are you excited about it? Or what can you tell us about
it?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm excited about it. I mean, I grew up reading the Thor comic books and reading Norse mythology and Lord of the Rings, which is based on Norse mythology. So Norse is something I've wanted to do since I was a kid. And I had the idea since I started Percy Jackson. I've known what the idea is going to be, I just haven't had a chance to do it. So finally I get to tackle the Norse gods in the modern world. I'm totally psyched about it. Yeah. I'm really looking forward to it.
Are there going to be any parallels between this world?
Yes, there are. Yeah, I mean, a lot of people have already noted that Annabeth Chase has the same last name as Magnus Chase.
Yes.
There's a reason for that.
Yeah,
not so much. They are related. And you'll find out how exactly and how they... how the worlds intermesh once I get going with it. But yeah, I mean, it'll be kind of the same thing that I'm known for. Modern day mythology, a lot of action, a lot of humor. It's set in Boston, which is where I'm living now, and is a great location for, you know, some berserkers to go running around. So looking forward to it.
That's awesome. Well, I know I speak for a lot of people on BookTube when I say that your writing has definitely impacted a lot of us. With yearly anticipation and unexpected education on Greek mythology, and just what's it all been like for you?
It's been amazing and kind of surreal. I never really anticipated the kind of reaction that the books got. And I love your phrase, unexpected education, because I think that's the best kind.
It definitely
is. It's when you're not really being told you have to learn something, but you're learning something because you have the opportunity and it's fun. And if that comes out of the books, then hey, I feel like I've done my job.
Of course. Well, thank you so much for being here.
It's
awesome. Is this sort of like your first exposure to BookTube? Do you even know what that is?
I do know, but yes, but I don't follow it, but I'll have to know.
I think you should.
Yeah.
You're going to be on it soon.
Excellent. All right. Thanks so much.
All right. Thank you so much. I'm Tiernan.
Oh, right, and I'm Rick Riordan.
Right, okay. I'll see you soon. Bye.